In this edition of Art Loft, a rebellious style meets haute couture.
I think what's interesting is that there seems to be a disjuncture between the idea of haute couture and punk.
This preeminent Haitian author is back with a new novel.
I think a lot of Claire is me.
The final exhibition before a new chapter begins.
He started to incorporate Afro-Cuban mythology.
And an artist in residence finds art in the smallest details.
A lot of the little coral pieces that I've been picking up, they have these really beautiful repeated circles.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, the Miami-Dade County Tourist Development Council, the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from Pan American Art Projects, this is Art Loft. Punk fashion was meant to be a rebuttal to all the cultural excess of the 60s and 70s. The style was supposed to highlight the individuals, the politically conscious, and the disenfranchised. And even though punk style continues to pay homage to rebels, it's now been recognized as high fashion that can be worn by all who crave an outlet to express themselves. Next, we visit the Punk Chaos to Couture exhibit at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City, and we learn how punk became high fashion.
The exhibition really focuses on the impact of punk on high fashion. We wanted to start off the exhibition with the origins of punk, both in New York and in London, in a way to contextualize the fashions on display. New York is really where punk originated. Patti Smith once famously said that all the action happened in the toilets at CBGB's. We have recreated the toilet and presented it as a period room. Primarily, punk in New York was more of a music phenomenon with artistic and intellectual underpinnings, whereas punk in London was more of a fashion movement, really, and it had more socio-political underpinnings. In London, we recreated the boutique 430 King's Road, which was a boutique that was created by Malcolm McLaren and Vivienne Westwood. And I think more than any other designer, it really was Vivienne Westwood and Malcolm McLaren who not only crystallized the look of punk, but also commercialized it. I think one of the sort of critiques of the co-option of punk by high fashion designers is the fact that it's for commercial gain. But punk, as articulated by McLaren and Westwood, it very much was a commercial enterprise. Bridging the Tale of Two Cities is a room called Clothes for Heroes, and Clothes for Heroes was a slogan under which McLaren and Westwood marketed their fashions, their clothes. And what we've done is actually juxtapose original punk fashions by McLaren and Westwood with contemporary designers like Christopher Bailey for Burberry, Rodarte, really to show the sort of enduring impact of McLaren and Westwood's punk aesthetic. After you go through Clothes for Heroes, the remaining sections of the exhibition are really focusing on high fashion. And to me, I think that the greatest and most enduring legacy of the punk aesthetic is the idea of do-it-yourself. There's four manifestations of do-it-yourself, as originally articulated by punks in the mid-70s. The gallery hardware focuses on perhaps the most obvious and the most formalistic aspects of do-it-yourself, which is the sort of hardware that punks use to imbue their clothing with an aesthetic of violence, anarchy, and even cruelty. So pieces like studs or safety pins or chains or zippers, these are perhaps the most obvious go-to aspects of punk fashion that designers have appropriated. Designers like Versace, But it also has garments by Zandra Rhodes, dated to 1977, from a collection called the Conceptual Chic Collection. And that really was the first time that a designer co-opted the punk aesthetic for high fashion. The next gallery is bricolage, and bricolage references the found objects that punks often would incorporate into the clothing, primarily as really a critique on the idea of good taste and also aspects of consumerism. And punks often would co-opt objects from the basest of context, and they would incorporate those into the clothing really as a manifestation or a challenge to what we mean by good taste and bad taste. I think one of the heroes of that gallery is Martin Margiela. Martin Margiela is known for incorporating found objects into his clothing. So we have waistcoats made out of broken ceramic dishes and held together with wire. In the center of that gallery are some extraordinary dresses by the designer Gareth Pugh, which are entirely made out of garbage bags that he shredded to look like feathers and fur. The third gallery after bricolage is a gallery called Graffiti. And graffiti is similar to hardware in the fact that it's a very self-evident expression of do-it-yourself. And it references the slogans and the stenciling and the different types of graffiti that punks would use as a way of challenging the establishment, as challenging the status quo. I think one of the highlights is perhaps addressed by Alexander McQueen. And in the middle of that gallery, we have four ball gowns by Dolce & Gabbana. And then the final gallery is called Destroy. And Destroy looks at, I think, perhaps what is the most enduring legacy of the DIY aesthetic on high fashion, which is the idea of deconstructionism, and references the rips, tears, and slashes that punks would incorporate into their clothing, really as symbols of urban dereliction and urban destitution. I think the hero of that gallery is probably Rei Kawakubo. And I think more than any other designer, Rei has taken on the mantle of punk. She looks to punk almost as an intellectual paradigm. She's continued the idea of rips and tears into her fashions, but she goes many steps further in deconstructionism, where she in a way challenges the formal logic of clothing by having jackets morphing into skirts, skirts morphing into jackets with arms protruding on the skirt. So her clothes not only take on the punk tactics of shock and provocation, they continue the language of punk into a 21st century idiom. I think what's interesting is that there seems to be a disjuncture between the idea of haute couture and punk, but I think both very much focused on concepts of individuality and concepts of novelty, and I think that's something they share very much in common. I think what was interesting about punks is that they did challenge these very normative conventions of beauty and fashion. I don't think you're seeing that anymore on the street, and where you really are seeing it is the runway. So in that respect, high fashion has completely overtaken punk in terms of this arena in which individualism, which creativity, in which artistic expression is celebrated above the idea of just the status quo.
To learn more about the exhibit, visit metmuseum.org.
And here we're really looking at some kind of a mental landscape, trying to kind of illustrate his subconscious in some way.
Author Edwige Dantecot has become one of the most respected literary voices of the Haitian diaspora. It's been nearly a decade since she last published a work of fiction, and her latest novel, Claire of the Sea Light, once again opens a door on the Haitian experience with universal overtones. We sat with Ms. Dantecot in our studio to discuss her newest work.
It's been about 10 years since I wrote my last book of fiction. Since then, I wrote a memoir called Brother, I'm Dying, a collection of essays, Create Dangerously, and two children's books. But I haven't published fiction in about 9 years. I find that fiction takes a longer time to process. For example, during the earthquake and many of these very large events in Haiti, I was writing this book, but I paused and I wrote a lot of essays. I wrote mostly nonfiction, and I think part of that was my way of processing what was happening. I lost some family members in the earthquake. I lost some family members to UN police and violence during that time. So it just didn't feel like a time to write fiction when the when the reality and the facts were so pressing for the country, for the diaspora, but also in my personal life. Well, Clair of the Sealet, I think it's a combination of meditation on parenthood, on difficult circumstances, because at the center of the plot line, you have a father who is deciding whether to keep his daughter with him and live with her in extreme poverty or give her to a better off woman and separate from her. So that's a very hard decision that a lot of parents unfortunately must make, not just in Haiti, but in many places in the developing world. So there's that meditation on the sacrifice of parenthood, but it's also told from the point of view of the title character, Claire Limielame, who's Claire of the Sea Light, and her perspective on that, how a child perceives that kind of choice, that kind of separation. I think a lot of Claire is me. Our stories are, by you know, the timeline and everything is quite different, but like Claire, I grew up with family members. My mother and father were in the United States, and I grew up in my uncle's house with my aunt and uncle for about 8 years. I was separated from my parents, so I had a lot of my childhood without them, but I knew that they loved me. I spoke to them all the time. We wrote each other letters, but it was a very difficult choice that they have to make, whether they would stay with us in poverty or whether they would come to the United States and work and try to build a better life for themselves and for us, and then later send for us. Well, I started writing about Claire initially and her father, and then as I was writing, this town showed up. And I think in the book, the town is as much a character as any of these individual stories. And there are many models, books that I had read, like Jean Toomer's Kane and Sherwood Anderson's Winesburg, Ohio, which are books about towns that sort of encouraged me to not give up the direction in which the book wanted to go. So after writing about Claire, these chapters kept coming, and I just sort of wrote them in that way. Initially, I thought I was writing a book about a radio show and that each chapter was going to be an episode of the show. And so it had a structure like this where different moments or different pieces might stand alone and add up to a block of a story. But this is how it came. And once, you know, I had one other person, then it seemed like this is the structure the book wanted to have. So no book can really resolve all anybody's issues, even the best self-help books in the world. What the process of writing this book has done for me is that I think it's sort of allowed me to reflect on certain things, to reflect on losses, the country's losses, my losses, and sometimes put through the mouth of certain characters things that I'm feeling. So it allows for an outlet, but it's never a complete resolution.
Ms. Dantecott will also be on hand at the Miami Book Fair this fall to talk more about her work. The fair turns 30 this year and promises to be an extraordinary event. For more information on the author's readings, including Edwidge Dantecott, visit miamibookfair.com.
Even as I'm creating something that is purely abstract in the end, it is made up of a sum of all these different parts of the landscape that I'm in, and it does feel very tied to this specific place.
MAM, the Miami Art Museum, recently closed its doors in preparation for its move to a brand new waterfront venue in downtown Miami, where it will reemerge as PAM, Perez Art Museum Miami. Before closing at the old location, Art Loft caught up with the museum's curator for a sneak peek at Frames of Reference, Latin American Art, the final exhibit for MAM and the end of an era. Check it out.
We have been the Miami Art Museum since 1996, and in 2011, the developer Jorge Perez gave a large donation of money and art to the museum, and we're renaming the museum in his honor. And this exhibition showcases a selection of works from that donation.
I started collecting in college, actually, in the late 60s, early 70s. Always had a love for the art, so first time I could put some dollars together, I bought a couple of lithographs to put in my room in my college campus.
This exhibition is called Frames of Reference. The collection has been, for Jorge, a reference to his own cultural roots. He is Latin American. He was born of Cuban parents, but in Argentina. He grew up in Colombia.
I wanted to make my career and my life here in the United States. And at the same time, I was really having problems with nostalgia. And art was a way of keeping those roots alive. It was a way of connecting back to Latin America, you know, connecting back to Latin American art, Latin American culture.
This is a painting by Wilfredo Lam, who is a Cuban artist working in the 20th century. He started to incorporate Afro-Cuban mythology and imagery into this real modernist language. He's working, it looks almost like a sketch or unfinished, but he did many paintings during this period with this very wide, ghost-like surface, you know, a very tentative touch on it, and it almost is like a cloud, or that you have to look very carefully to see the outlines of a figure where it's the back of a woman, creatures, and he did a lot of figures that were sort of horse women, but also have these sort of bulbous forms that are referencing African goddesses. So he was very important in mixing these traditions between Africa, Europe, the Caribbean. So this is a painting by Roberto Mata, and here we're really looking at some kind of a mental landscape, trying to kind of illustrate his subconscious in some way. Beautifully painted, if you look at it very carefully, it's kind of oil paint that's been scraped away and reveals part of the canvas and has a lot of depth to it. It has this feeling of space. This is a still life by the Cuban artist Amalia Pelaez, done in 1935. And this artist did a lot of interiors, Havana interiors, where you can see the tile floors of a traditional Havana home with a curtain on one side and an abstraction of a plant, perhaps a cactus. The way she uses line is quite beautiful. Sometimes it's very heavy, and other times it almost kind of disappears into the background. She's quite known for her still lifes and sort of cut open fruit, often with women in these domestic interiors. This is a painting by Jose Bedia, who is a Cuban artist who's lived in Miami since 1993, called Cuánto Valió Mi Cobayende. And he's talking about Cobayende as kind of San Lázaro in Afro-Cuban religion. It's sort of a mixing of Christian and African traditions. The scale, it feels like a god or some sort of powerful being. And then if you look carefully, these kind of red splotches are, this figure is wounded in some way and asking to be healed. He's an artist who really looks at this kind of mixing of religions and is a real kind of spiritual, always looking for the spiritual dimension and how to represent it visually. Frames of Reference, the title, talks about how this collection will serve as a frame of reference for us in the museum and for our public. And our public is very much a large percentage of people from Latin American backgrounds, and we hope that these works will serve as a frame of reference to their own cultural identities as well.
The brand new center, PAM, will officially open its doors to the public in December 2013, just in time for Art Basel Miami. But if you'd like to get a sneak peek at what's to come, check out PAM.org.
First of all, I'm playing with the material, the colors, and then I'm playing with this new found, game with the computer.
Our final story takes us to the Armory on White Street in Key West, home of the studios of Key West. Amy Chan was an artist in residence there this past summer. Chan, who teaches at the University of Virginia and at VCU, is a painter who draws her inspiration from the patterns she finds in nature, and naturally, Key West was an exciting opportunity for her to experience a new locale. We spent some time with Amy as she approached the midpoint in her residency. Here is her story.
I'm
My name is Amy Chan. I'm coming here from Richmond, Virginia, to Studios of Key West, and it's my first time visiting Key West. I teach at Virginia Commonwealth University and the University of Virginia, and I'm a painter. Well, I applied to the residency. I do residencies quite often because I really like to get outside of my own home to, you know, get inspiration, move around, and have that really nice concentrated block of time to make work. And the studios looked like a really great opportunity, so I applied and luckily got in. I'm specifically interested in coral, in rocks. I've been doing a little bit of snorkeling and the colors of the wildlife and the, you know, the flora and fauna here. I'm primarily a painter. I mean, I am thinking and looking at the landscape a lot, but I do create abstract paintings. I mean, in a way, you kind of couldn't pull their source from them just looking at them without an explanation. When I first got here, I pretty much spent the whole week collecting imagery. I'm taking photographs, doing drawings, and actually picking things up off the ground to bring back here and study. And so I feel like I'm always thinking about patterns that I can see in the landscape that I'm like taking out of their context and changing them around. So I feel like even as I'm creating something that is purely abstract in the end, it is made up of a sum of all these different parts of the landscape that I'm in. And it does feel very tied to the specific place for me in terms of the colors that I'm using, the shapes and the textures. Like, one of the first things that I was interested in when I came down here was that very Florida-like concrete block that they use to build homes, like suburban homes around here. So I started doing drawings of those like decorative concrete blocks that get painted in all kinds of different colors. I'm generally interested in things that have a relationship to pattern. I'm very interested in wallpaper designs, patterns that occur naturally, like sort of scientific illustration books, things that I find in there. And so things that I find in nature that mimic that, I think are interesting. Like a lot of the little coral pieces that I've been picking up, they have these really beautiful repeated circles and lines and dots all over them that kind of like has drawn me to those shapes. And then I start drawing them, and when you do, you know, drawing or sketching of something, you sort of find other things that you're interested in with that. The top one is the one that I'm working on right now, and since I've only been here for 2 weeks, a lot of the stuff in my studio is still kind of halfway done, so I don't really think any of these are finished. But this top one, I started out with a screen printed background that I actually did before I came here, and I'm just layering colors and, you know, kind of enjoying creating an interesting composition without really knowing what the painting's gonna turn into. And then from my walks around here and collecting little rocks and pieces of coral, I started to build sort of a collection of drawings of shapes that interest me, and those shapes got kind of scattered onto that page in a composition. I mean, I'm drawing them, so I'm taking things that I'm finding around, and I'm just doing drawings, things like this, and making notes on what I like about them. If you can see those, these are just like ink and watercolor drawings, and playing with color and pattern, and then distilling those into more finished paintings. So whenever I travel to residencies, I'm always looking for what's unique about that place that I can't get at home. I could pretty much say everything here is unique about this place compared to where I'm from.
To see some of Amy's completed works from her residency, visit her website at amychan.org. And if you want to find out information about the Studios of Key West and their Artist in Residency program, look online at tskw.org. And that wraps it up for another edition of Art Loft. For more arts and culture, visit wpbt2.org/artloft, where you'll find featured videos, blogs, and information on upcoming arts events. And you can also watch older episodes of Art Loft. And be sure to look for us on Facebook and Twitter at ArtLoftSFL. Until next week, I'm Kalyn James, reminding you to stay creative. Thanks for watching.
look better if it's you and not me. Uh-oh. Now it's ready. Can you take it back down just a little bit? Please, sir. And thank you. That's perfect. It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft. Okay, good.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, the Miami-Dade County Tourist Development Council, the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.